It's the Son of the Redeemed, rising from the
To your name be the glory, because your love and faithfulness.
Glory. welcome you to church this morning here at Madison Church of Christ. We're glad that you're here. We would love it if you would take a moment and find someone maybe you haven't seen for a couple weeks or something. Go shake a hand and welcome them as well. So if you would, make your way around the room and welcome somebody today. Again, we're thankful for your presence here today, grateful that you've joined us to say not about us, it's about Him. We lift up our voices to Him, and when we really pause to consider His goodness and His greatness, we're pretty humbled by His goodness to us. And so together we lift up His name each and every Sunday morning here at the church. Just a couple announcements. CCW is here at the church. I think there was confusion. It was at Marie's house, but it is here at the church on Thursday, so the bulletin is right on that. There is a prayer meeting tonight. National Day of Prayer is usually on a Thursday, but we're getting together tonight, and we encourage you, if you want to come pray for our country or whatever prayer concerns you have, 6 o'clock tonight. Meet us here for that. Youth group will be at 8 o'clock tonight. There is a board meeting following church today. Coming up next couple weeks, next week is Mother's Day. I know that we have a nice gift for our moms and ladies that day. And 2 weeks from today will be graduation. We'll celebrate high school graduations, which reminds me, if you have a son or daughter in college that's graduating, we usually don't recognize them heavy, but sometimes we'll put the announcements on the screen or something like that. So if you have a son or daughter or a grandson or granddaughter that you want mentioned that graduated from college, people do kind of enjoy knowing. We lose track of them after high school sometimes. So if you want them mentioned, holler at somebody in the know, and we'll get those names on the screen. But anyway, that's what's coming up. We have Pilgrim Heights at the end of the month. That's just a fun family gathering at Pilgrim Heights Church Camp, not too far from the casino, if that helps you out any at all right? Not that I've seen you there lately or anything like that, but it's just about a mile from the casino, and it's a gorgeous camp facility. It's great for young people. It's great for older folks, and we'll have a little worship service. We'll start at 3 o'clock and grill out and just enjoy a night at the lake. It's a real pretty place and a lot of fun. So those are what's coming up. As far as prayer time, I just know each week, we pretty much say not to us, but really we get caught up in our own concerns, and why wouldn't we? But I know as we come into a room like this, there's a variety of concerns. I mean, some are concerned about aging parents and taking care of them, and sometimes health issues get burdensome to us. Some are work-related, just conflict at work. Could be a variety of things. There's relationship issues that we come, and yet we come into church, and we don't think through those things. But as we sit in the midst of one another, we know that there's a lot of concerns. And so I just wanted to share some good news with you. If you come with concerns today, it comes from Philippians 4:7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. The peace of God. Sometimes that's hard to understand. And yet if we look at Scripture, peace was given many, many times, even to Jesus as He approached the cross. The good news is, no matter what you're dealing with, could be a list of things, there can be peace in the midst of turmoil, peace in the midst of chaos, because your God is the God that's in control. So whatever your concerns are today, just want you to bring those before the Lord as we share some quiet time and some stillness before the Lord this morning. So number of prayer requests were on the screen. A number of them are in our bulletins. So I just want you to bow and just quietly, and I'll give you just a little quiet time just to take a deep breath. Ask the God of peace to deliver his peace, no matter what the turmoil, no matter the chaos. You know, it's kind of a discouraging week if you look in terms of our country. Lots going on in our country and Supreme Court decisions and difficult things that they're just hard to understand. I mean, there's some crazy things happening in our society and stuff that the church is going to have to deal with at some point in time and just difficult issues. And so I'm encourage you to lift up our country as well as decisions are being made of that type of thing. But whatever your concerns are, just quietly approach his throne of grace right now. Father, when we're quiet before you, sometimes we just get a better picture, a better glimpse of who you are and your greatness and your bigness. And so we're thankful for the quiet moments. We don't fill our lives with enough of those just to put our focus and thought on you. So thank you that you can provide peace, even in the midst of our struggles and difficulties. Father, we ask that you be with our country as decisions are being made that affect us somehow. If they don't affect us, they affect our kids and our grandkids, and they affect the church. And so we just ask that you would work. Change probably won't happen through our political systems. It just change happens in the hearts of men and women, and we know that you can change those hearts. And so we just ask that that you watch over, and may your will be done. Father, again, for each person here, we're grateful. We bring our concerns before you, but we ask for a spirit of peace that only you can give. May it guide us this morning. May our worship be acceptable to you as we continue now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. I see we're going to have a little message on some faith, keeping our faith in balance this morning. So I thought I'd go ahead and do a little bit on faith for this meditation. In the fourth chapter of Romans, we see here where Abraham is justified by his faith. Then we go into the fifth chapter, and it talks about our peace and our joy that we have through our faith in Jesus Christ. And I'd like to read just a few passages here, starting in the first verse of chapter 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. We rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings. How many of you rejoice in your sufferings? Because, it says, we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance then produces character. Character produces hope. The hope that does not disappoint us. Because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. The Holy Spirit is one of those things that we seem like we don't talk a lot about in church. But it's evident here that the Trinity, God the Father, who loved us enough that he gave his Son, and then the Son left and gave the Holy Spirit. So all three work together in order to build our faith, our perseverance, our character, and all of those things. This morning we come around and we celebrate a time where Jesus laid down his life for each and every one of us. And I like to finish up with this passage. Verse 6, you see that at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Now very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. See, it didn't take us being good for us to be saved. It took Jesus being who he was to save us. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we gather around this table this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts, with praise that for who you are, that you would love us enough, and though we are unworthy to be called your children, you redeem us, buy us back through the blood of Jesus Christ. We celebrate that time now in the remembrance of what he did for each and every one of us through these emblems, the bread representing the broken body, the juice that represents the spilled blood, in order to wash away our sins. Father, might we take the faith that we do have and put it into action to make it stronger. And we thank you for the hope that we have that one day we can all rejoice and be together with you in heaven. These things we all lift up in Jesus' name. Amen.
us courage, give us wisdom to stand up for you. And Lord, we just thank you. We just ask you to bless this offering and bring glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Again, we're looking at our misperceptions that the people have about the church, about our faith sometimes. This is our fourth week at looking at different misperceptions that they have. Week number one, we looked at the misperception that the church just isn't for everybody. There's just some people that the church isn't for. And hopefully we dispelled that myth, especially the gospel of Jesus Christ was meant for everybody. We talked about sowing seed. Hopefully we're doing our part that way whenever we have opportunity. We talked about the common misconception or misperception that the church is full of hypocrites. And we realized we probably have a share, and we talked about being a Pharisee, and you might be a Pharisee if, and we probably saw ourselves a little bit somewhere in that list. Last week we talked about, well, in the end, all works out good, they're in a better place, everybody will be saved. God is a loving God, and no way would a loving God send anybody to hell. That just doesn't make sense. But we realize there will be a separation. Jesus tells some stories, and there will be a separation. The good fish, the bad fish, the sheep and the goats, the wheat and the wheats will at some point be harvested. And so we realize not everybody goes to heaven. Those who place their faith in Jesus Christ and have that blessed promise. Today we look at another, I think it's a common misperception. I don't think you hear it as often, but there's people out there that say, just keep your faith in balance. Don't go overboard. Don't get too fanatical about it. Don't be crazy about what you believe. And on paper, that sounds pretty good. We don't want to be one of those extremists. Parents whose kids go to Bible college sometimes, where especially if mom and dad haven't grown up in the church and had to deal with that before, is they want to go to Bible college for a year or maybe pursue ministry or whatever. And there's parents who are real concerned. We just don't want you to become one of those religious, crazy people, you know, that you read about in the paper. And so there's this fear. Just keep it in balance. Just keep it in balance. And so when we think of balance, we think it's a good thing. We think, well, have a little bit of church, a little bit of family, a little bit of work, a little bit of pleasure and hobbies. And if we just keep all those things in balance, life would be good. And on paper, that sounds good. You know, our priorities sort of change a little bit, but we should have just a little bit of church, a little bit of that, a little bit of, you know. And on paper, that seems to make sense, but you don't find that in the stories that Jesus shared. He says you need to be all in. You need to be 100% here. And so it's just kind of a common misperception. We don't want to be too over the top, too crazy, too fanatical, too passionate. And it's okay, but just keep it in balance. And I suppose, I wanted to ask you a question. Is it possible to get too crazy, to get too passionate about your faith in Jesus Christ, about God? Is it possible to go over the top? Might depends on how you define crazy or over the top. Some have taken it to the extreme, and we're reminded of abortion clinics where some Christian took it to the extreme and thought they'd take matters in their own hand and end up murdering somebody. We're familiar with those stories from the past or those type of situations. Those are the extreme things, okay? So I suppose it could lead you that way. Obviously, that was misguided and wrong and against God's will. But another probably better definition of being too crazy or too fanatical or too passionate might be zealous, or diehard, or a fervent devotee, devoted to some cause, to something. We understand that. I know many Christians who fit that bill. They're fully devoted to Jesus Christ. That's what we're talking about today. It's not just a little bit. It's 100%. I'm all in when it comes to my faith in Jesus Christ. That's my guiding force. That's how I make my decisions. That's how I do. Everything else revolves around that. Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I think sometimes those who have this misperception to keep everything in balance don't understand the rewards that are those that are there for those who are in Jesus Christ. There are some rewards that belong to those who are all in. Funny how we, other arenas of life, it's okay to be fanatical. It's okay to be a crazy fan. Turn on the football game and it might be minus 30 degrees in Green Bay, but you see the cheeseheads and you see the shirts off and you see them with Packers written on their stomachs as they're lined up and they're going crazy. And we go, man, they are really committed to the Packers. Some would say they need to be committed. But it's okay if we're an Iowa Hawkeye fan and we think it's really crazy if you give your money to the church. I mean, but we don't forget, it's not so crazy if you're an Iowa Hawkeye fan or an Iowa State fan or whatever fan you're a fan of to go tailgating and spend a bunch of money there, to fly to a game or fly to the bowl game and to spend oodles of dollars. We don't think that's crazy. We think that's fully devoted. I'm all in when it comes to my favorite team. I'm all in. We would call that dedicated, fully devoted. But somehow when a Christian starts professing their faith, we think it's extreme. We think it should be kept in balance, kept in line. People who, you're really going to give money to that cause? You're going to support that mission? You're going to go that way? I remember when we went to Mexico one time, we'd stopped and we were at a gas station. A man said, "What are you guys doing down here?" And it was an American. And I said, "Hey, we're here just to build a couple homes and to share with children in an impoverished area and help a local church and a local pastor." And he says, "Really? That's crazy." He says, "All these kids?" I said, "How much are they paying you to do that?" We're like, "No, I don't think you get it. We're paying for the house. We're paying for the materials. We're paying our way to go into Mexico and do this." He's like, "You guys are nuts. You guys are crazy." I mean, he could not get the concept that we would pay for this ourselves. Our faith was fanatical to him. And I said, "What do you do?" He says, "Well, I own 3 strip bars." I said, you're the crazy one, I said. "You're the crazy one. You spend money on that." But he was all about making money. The world doesn't understand our craziness at times. Jesus tells a story, again, in Matthew 13, if you turn there, verse 44. This parable really illustrates a passion that a man had. A couple stories we'll look at today, very short, very easy to understand. 2 parables, 2 comparisons. In our story, Jesus compares Christianity to a man who had found a valuable treasure in a field that he was plowing. It shows us the importance of the kingdom of God and why Jesus is worthy of our wholehearted devotion. It certainly goes against about the misconception, the misperception that we're talking about today, just to be balanced. Verse 44, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." End of story 1. Verse 45, "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it." Not in balance, all in. Those stories might sound a little bit odd to us. I mean, how many people are just going to go find a treasure in their field? I mean, we've never heard of that hardly. I mean, who knows? Maybe someone's bought an old barn and found a treasure in there or something from time to time. But this was not a foreign thing to them. I mean, apparently this man had a hired hand of some sort, had been plowing, found a treasure, and apparently the owner had died, and finders keepers. That was the rule of the land. And so he covers it back up, goes home, probably tells his wife, "Guess what? We're selling all and we're going to buy this farm." Someone didn't understand the reward. That sounded like a risky venture, but it really wasn't. Wasn't unusual. I mean, there's other stories about burying your treasure. Remember the parable or the talents? The man who was given 10, 5, 2, 1 talent, they hid him in the ground. The one that hid in the ground was the one who paid the price, and Jesus was very upset. The owner came back and said, "You didn't do anything with what I gave you. You buried it in the ground. So this wasn't an unusual story. It wasn't unusual. They didn't have a banking system where they could go down to Wells Fargo and deposit that and take that and feel safe about it. They had to do something with their finances back then. So it wasn't uncommon for them to bury it in the ground. Treasures. Imagine this man was excited when he found this treasure. Have you ever thought about the treasures that are ours because we profess Jesus as our Savior? What about the treasure of forgiveness of sins? How much would you be willing to pay to have every sin you've ever committed erased? What's it worth to know your past is done? Completely. What would that be worth to you? What's it worth to know that you stand before God, the maker of the universe, clothed in His Son's righteousness? Every act of disobedience forgiven. That's the promise. That's the promise. That's not a dream. What is that worth? That's a treasure. If anyone is Christ, and if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. That's a treasure. The treasure of being baptized and being forgiven of sins and being guilt-free. That's a treasure. What would that be worth to you? What about in Christ? We have this treasure called eternal life to spend the rest of our time, the rest of our days, our eternity in heaven with Jesus. What would that be worth? We take it for granted because we've heard about it since a little kid. But when you die, to know that's not it, that you have heaven waiting for you, what would that be worth to you? Those are treasures that are ours because we're in Jesus Christ, just to name a few. Jesus tells these two parables to illustrate the kingdom of heaven is so valuable, worth so much, that it's worth whatever it has you have to do to obtain it. That's the point of these parables. No matter what you have to do to obtain it, it's worth it. I'm all in. Whatever you have to do, it's worth it. Not a little bit. Not a little bit here, not a little bit there. You need to be all in, fully vested, fully devoted. In the parable, we see the man sold all he had. Some would say, this man is passionate about buying this land. Some would say, he's crazy, fanatical to take a risk like that. They didn't understand the reward that was him becoming that landowner. I think it's true today too. People understand the rewards. So when we get outspoken, when we live by faith, they don't get it. They don't understand the rewards. What great thing has ever been accomplished without passion being the driving force? I suppose there's something. But it seems like passion is just that ingredient that makes great things happen. It makes things that are impossible possible. When someone's passionate about something, all of a sudden it seems like that could never happen, and it sometimes happens. Passion's important. Passion gives us a reason to wake up in the morning to decide, I'm going to do something with my life that matters. Passion. Without passion, life becomes mundane. Life becomes boring, ho-hum, routine. Passion is what mobilizes individuals to do great things. It also mobilizes groups of people to do great things. Passion, it makes us stay up late or get up early to do something. Passion makes good athletes great athletes. Good musicians, incredible musicians, when they're passionate about what they do. One day a man walks up to Jesus and says, hey, out of all the commandments, what's the greatest one? What's the greatest one? Well, I want a laser beam here. I want to know what's the most important one. Cut through the chase. What's most important? Jesus says, love the God. Love your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Easy to understand. Love the Lord, your God, with 10% of your heart. Tithe your heart. Oh, you're all in. all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. You want to know what's most important? That's what Jesus told him. And the second command, love others. Love others. Be passionate about those things. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love others. That's not half-hearted. That's fully devoted. That's all in. That's not partial. That's not keeping your priorities straight. It says, I'm all in when it comes to my faith in God. All throughout Scripture, we see other signs that say you need to be all in. Colossians 3:23, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart. Work heartily as working for the Lord. Whatever you do. It doesn't say you have to be a minister. It doesn't say you have to be a spiritual person that way. You don't have to be involved in some professional paid ministries. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord. You're all in. Whatever you do, whatever your hands do, wherever it takes you, wherever your feet take you, you're all in. Why? Because you know you will receive inheritance from the Lord. It's the Lord Jesus Christ whom you are serving. Colossians 3:23 says you're all in. No matter what you do, work heartedly, not half-heartedly. All throughout Scripture, that seems to be a common thing. Seek Him passionately, serve Him passionately, be all in. Amazing in America, it's okay to be passionate about anything else, but when we're passionate about our faith, we're looked at some religious crazy person. Think about the things we're passionate about. Sports, politics, fashion. Looking pretty good today, aren't I? Restaurants. We get passionate about which restaurant we're going to eat at. Hobbies, but not God. Don't be passionate about God and faith. That's crazy. I mean, we're passionate about birds, chocolate, books. Okay, ladies, I know chocolate's okay to be passionate about. Fishing, golf, gardening, mushroom hunting, roses, shoes. Not going to pick on the ladies. Next week's Mother's Day. Shoes. Guns. Some are passionate about guns. Cell phones, tablets, pets, and more. And we'll spend thousands on those things. How about that fight last night? Passionate fight. People were spending $40,000 a ticket. They interviewed a man from South Africa and his son. They spent $44,000 a ticket to go to the fight. They were listed at over $100,000 in some tickets. That's crazy. But we can be crazy about all those things, but when we're crazy about our faith, somehow it seems like that's a no-no. That's crazy. But Jesus says you need to be all in, fully devoted, serving the Lord. Romans 12:1, do not be slothful in zeal, be fervent in spirit, serve the Lord. The NIV version says, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Never be lacking in zeal. Never be lacking in passion. Be passionate for the Lord. Keep your spiritual fervor. Interesting that he says keep your spiritual fervor. Why? Because sometimes we don't keep our spiritual fervor. Maybe we should underline that Romans passage. It's almost like it's a choice. It's almost like it's a discipline to stay passionate about those things that really matter. It's not automatic. We get distracted. Most of life tries to pull us in a completely opposite direction than to be passionate and full of zeal for the Lord, to be fully devoted, to be all in. But passion, to be passionate for the Lord, has nothing to do with how old we are, how young we are, our abilities, has nothing to do with that. Churches have many folks who've been fully committed followers for years and years. Our church has fully devoted followers. They've been passionate about Jesus for years. It has nothing to do with age. But sometimes we don't keep our spiritual fervor. Sometimes it gets drowned out by other activities. So how do we keep passion for the Lord? How do we deal with that? Well, here's some passion killers. that I've experienced in my life, I've seen in other people's life. Number one, it could be an unbalanced schedule, busyness, or we could be overworking, or we could be underworking. Either one's a passion killer. And my guess is we have all those in this room today, some who work long hours and overwork, and then they wonder why they're dry spiritually. And some don't have enough to do, and they become busybodies, and they wonder why spiritually they're just not on fire. In that instance, we probably need balance. But an unbalanced schedule keeps us, our passion from growing. An unused or a talent that God has given you, or a gift that He's given you, 1 Peter 4:10, each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various form. Your gift, your abilities are meant to serve one another. I love coffee time. I love the gifts that some of you have. You're using your gifts to sweeten us up a little bit. But when we don't use the gift that God's given us, a spiritual gift, we become ho-hum. And we lose our purpose and we lose our zeal for the Lord. Unresolved conflict. Job 5:2 says, resentment kills the fool, but envy slays the simple. If we're dealing with unresolved conflict, oftentimes within families, all of a sudden our zeal for the Lord, our passion for the Lord is squashed. Hebrews 10:24 says, you need to spend time with others who are passionate about the Lord. That's why I love our Sunday mornings. This is a chance to be around people who love the Lord. They're fully devoted. And when we spend time with those people, it rekindles our fire. When I see someone serving, I want to serve. When I see someone giving, I want to give. When I see someone reaching out, I want to reach out. And so we have to spend a little bit of time with each other. Sometimes we forget our purpose. Our purpose is to give glory to God in all we say and do. And we forget our purpose. And when we forget our purpose, we lose our passion. What's your purpose for getting up in the morning? Oftentimes, we lose this passion, this zeal, this excitement for the Lord when we don't spend any time in His Word, when we don't nourish our souls. Isn't it amazing when you do have a little bit of time with the Lord? Maybe it's in the outdoors or whatever fashion you like it to be. When you read God's Word, it's amazing how that fans the flame and our spiritual desire goes up and our service to the Lord increases as well. Oftentimes, another thing that squashes or puts out the fire of enthusiasm is just an unconfessed sin, a sin that we haven't dealt with and we've sort of brushed aside, a sin that we talked about earlier we like to manage rather than deal with it. We just say, hey, I'm just going to live with this sin. I'm going to hide it, be hypocritical about it. Unconfessed sin can make us lose our zeal for the Lord as well. And so I share those reminders just as a reminder that maybe something triggers something in you today. Maybe the Holy Spirit will use that. Maybe we need to address some of those things that have zapped our passion. In Christ, we have a treasure called hope. What would you pay? What's it worth? Acts 4:12, salvation is found in nobody else. No one else. There is no other name under heaven given to us, given to man, by which we must be saved. Salvation is found in Jesus Christ. That's a treasure. And it can't be found in anybody else. It's the only name that can provide salvation. And when you discover that salvation, that begins to kindle your passion. Your passion grows. How much is a friend worth? I don't know. How much is everlasting love worth? I don't know if you can put a price tag on it. Jeremiah says, He loves you with an everlasting love. An everlasting love. Another treasure that we have because we're in Jesus Christ. I don't know if you've been watching, I think it's called AD, the Bible. I'm not sure what it's called, but if you've been watching that, you cannot escape. I've enjoyed it. I haven't watched every one, I don't think, but man, each one I watch, I'm touched by it, and I see the passion that Peter has. And how that spills over, and all the difficult decisions they have because they are all in. They are fully vested. They're fully devoted, and it affects everything they do. It wasn't just, oh, guys, you know, Jesus is gone. the pressure's on, our lives are at stake, I think I'll just worship quietly by myself, just a little bit on Sunday mornings. Now, they're all in, like, how are we going to grow this thing? We need to pray, and we need the God's Spirit, and it was, they were all in. And I don't know if they got it 100% right, but I think they got that right. They were all in, fully devoted followers. Some would say crazy. But according to the stories that Jesus says, you need to be all in. Go sell all you have. Be all in. I don't think you have to be goofy. I'm just saying be fully devoted. And when you discover the treasure of salvation, it's worth giving up all you have in order to obtain it. Paul says, I consider everything rubbish compared to knowing Jesus Christ. I consider everything. And he had a list of accomplishments more than anybody here. He said, I consider that rubbish compared to that of knowing Jesus Christ. He was all in. He understood the rewards. He was all in. He was accused of losing his mind. Festus says, Paul, are you sure you want to be that way? He says, I'm all in. One of my favorite verses from Matthew, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. You want to be passionate about the Lord? Treasure the Lord in all ways. Crazy. Reminded of a missionary named Jim Elliot, probably the most influential missionary that's ever lived, probably, other than Paul, maybe. Went to serve the Indians. He lost his life. Crazy. And if you'd ever read through Gates of Splendor, you'd be touched by it. And it's led many to become missionaries. Just an amazing story of a man's passion. Some would say, he's crazy. Crazy that you would go over there. They knew they'd kill you, you know. But he was all in. And hearts were softened and lives were changed for the Lord. But he said this in his diary. You've probably heard it before. He is no fool who exchanges what he cannot keep for that which he can never lose. He was all in. No regrets. Fanatical? I don't know. Maybe. But to him, it was worth it all. He counted everything else rubbish for the sake of knowing Jesus. So when the world says, hey, keep everything in balance, you know, you can have your faith, you can do your little things on Sunday mornings, but make sure you balance out your family time, make sure you balance out all these things and your community service, and all those things are important. Don't understand me. But Jesus says, you need to be all in. Fully devoted. Let that be the center of your life and let that influence every other area. Let's stand as we sing.